overview of our press. We started in 2007. We've published 7 Wising Up anthologies with an 8th due out next month, Daring to Repair, What Is It, Who Does It, and Why. Our Wising Up Press Writers Collective has published 8 individually authored books, including novel, short story, essay, memoir, nonfiction, and poetry, with a 9th book due out next month, Carrie Langan's short story collection, Live Your Life and Other Stories. We see our books, especially our Wising Up anthologies, as catalysts for community, for both writers and readers, a way of deepening the conversations around areas of sticky or strident social concern, a deepening that is sometimes only possible through the mysterious mediation of the book. I'm going to talk a little bit about the why behind our press. Our press grew out of the Universal Table, an organization we founded in 2004, whose mission is exploring the complex challenges and lasting rewards of living up close and personal with pluralism in social, family, religious, and civic life, or more simply, finding the we and them, the us and you, wherever we are and whatever we are doing. For us, healthy relationality is core to how we publish and what we publish. It is also why we write, to enter into deeper and truer relationships, first with ourselves and our own experiences, and then with others and theirs. In other words, we're interested at any age in wising up together. This account will be a personal one because the press is something that has developed naturally out of my own personal history, experience, and commitments. I believe this congruence of experience and commitments is true for everyone involved in the press and is one of its strengths. I remember where I was sitting in the airport in San Francisco in late January 2004 when the idea of Universal Table came to me. I was returning from my last residential session for a program in spiritual direction I had attended for 3 years, a program where I had been a decided outlier and had frequently puzzled and at times anguished over the impact of unreflective communities based on assumptions of sameness that, for the very life of me, I could not share. Acknowledging this and my need for community, I suddenly found my voice. A voice that integrated both the gifts and the spurning of this experience in a way that welcomed more. I realized that this vision of a universal table, one that was based on an appreciation of our differences, that found in them our we, was intimately related to my experience of writing. It was something writing and reading gave me. It was something I both needed for myself and needed to provide others at the very same time. Originally, we thought of Universal Table as primarily conducting research and providing workshops, but the first sustained project I engaged in was an interfaith listening and writing project, God Speaks My Language, Can You?, that focused on spiritual autobiography. When after many interviews, I asked myself how I was listening, I realized the answer was very simple. I was listening as an artist, a creative writer, someone with an abiding trust in story, our story. What motivated me was making these stories, often so different from my own, safe for others with different beliefs to hear. I was always clear that I wanted Universal Table to publish this book. I wanted the generosity of the participants in that project to result in something tangible that I could share with them, that they in turn could share with others. I wanted us to be able to honor that commitment to the generosity of the participants without an intermediary. It was soon after this, I believe, that I woke up one morning with a clear conviction that we needed to go farther. We needed to start a press, because Charles and I were at heart writers, and there was something about the deep reflective process of writing that grounded us, allowed us to explore, invite, and welcome more freely. Charles agreed immediately because he too is a writer, and also because he'd grown up with a father who was a bookbinder, and who read every book he bound and still to this day remembers and shares what he learned from them. It was clear to us that our press would publish the stories of others, like those in God Speaks. But an interesting dimension of this clear conviction was that we would also publish my own books and Charles's books if he wanted, and also anthologies focused on those areas where we felt that our grounds of understanding each other as a society could be stretched, areas that spoke especially clearly to each or both of us because of our personal and or our professional interests. Immigration and acculturation, pluralism in families, love and aging, illness and meaning, and religious difference. The reason for including ourselves among the authors we published was pragmatic. It is our hard-won experience that we can't make a genuine space for others if we don't also make one for ourselves as well. In terms of the anthologies, we began our intense apprenticeship in bookmaking in the fall of 2007. So all the books that you see here have been published since then. And we began then with the simultaneous publication of our first Wisinghead anthology, Illness and Grace, Terror and Transformation, and two books of mine, Visible Signs, a novel, and Hearts as Big as Fists, a collection of short stories whose themes resonated with the anthology because illness and meaning is something I've worked on extensively. We've continued in the same way throughout, publishing anthologies and single-authored books whose themes resonate with one another. Our interest in developing the Wisinghead anthologies came from our interest in and commitment to fruitful pluralism, and our focus on fiction, poetry, and memoir uses the natural richness of narrative as a way to allow us to safely walk in someone else's shoes, look through their eyes, hold each other more generously in imagination and in life. Our editorial approach can be summarized in the same way we describe some of the activities that are natural offshoots of our publishing: writing for insight, reading for relation. This reading for relation takes place for us as editors as we hear resonances and feel new conceptual frames emerging as we read different authors exploring the same theme. Writing for insight comes for us as editors when we weave all those distinctive voices together in collections that try to shape and share that fascinating listening experience with others. Reading for relation comes into play again when we share those anthologies. It has delighted us that the authors in our anthologies often write us upon receiving their contributors' copies to say they feel honored to be included, which means to us that they have felt a sense of mutual amplification when their work is put in resonant conversation with that of others. We would like to note that many of our contributors are widely published, are writing teachers and instructors, and some are publishing their first poem in their 60s or 70s. But we hear in these comments is that they have each found in that anthology the we and them, the us and you, to which we personally are so committed. This is not necessarily where they begin, whatever their level of accomplishment. It seems to be the result of really experiencing through the reading of the finished work that their own work is enhanced, not diminished, by the whole. When at group readings of our contributors, like one we just had in Boston, we see the same thing happen. When people become as eager to listen to others as to express themselves, we feel that we've helped that universal table come into being. We feel the same way when people tell us they want to take our books home and share them with someone they know, someone whose own life would be expanded by coming into relation to these stories, knowing that they're not alone. And I want to talk a little bit about our Writers Collective. When we began the Wisinghead Writers Collective, we were inspired to do so by the talent of many of the writers who contributed to our anthologies, and who also felt a special affinity to the social commitments of Universal Table, who understood us when we said we wanted our books to be catalysts for conversation, and who had the same approach to their own writing. We've enjoyed watching their work develop over time, increasing in integrity and authority with the encouragement of publication. We have found it particularly rewarding to offer this encouragement at a point in a writer's life, whether that writer is 28 or 82, when it would make a significant difference in their artistic and personal development. However, one of the biggest challenges for us was trying to develop a model for publishing individual writers that felt relationally healthy to us. In my life as a writer, publication in and of itself was not a powerful motivator. For someone with extensive academic training in writing and a comfortable measure of artistic recognition through fellowships and publications, this now seems a little puzzling. It wasn't that I lacked ambition for my own development. I wrote a lot, okay? But many of my writer friends felt that their lives would be changed by their book being published. I think I felt my life would be transformed each time by writing the book, and that transformation felt very different from the experience of getting or being published, indeed often antithetical. I do remember shortly after graduate school suggesting to friends that we create a publishing collective inspired by the models of Leonard and Virginia Woolf's Hogarth Press and Lunsford and Gettysburg City Lights, so that people would just stop bitching all the time about agents who weren't doing their jobs, publishers they depended on but didn't like or trust. I believe I suggested calling it the White Hat Collective. since everyone seemed to be so miserably enmeshed with villains. These embittered and importunate attitudes just felt so out of sync with the empowering and integrating experience of writing, whose great gift was, I kept learning and relearning, to help us absorb what we've lived so far, so we could live the next year, or 5 years, or 10 years more wisely. Now, after we had started the press, as a writer-publisher, even if I felt that I was encountering writers with distinctive voices, with stories which could enlarge the conversations we wanted to develop, for whom publication at this point in their life would make a significant difference, it was still very hard for me to imagine donating our time and skills and money to enter into a relationship that was as mutually exploitive and distrusting as the ones between writers and publishers that I had often seen. Who in their right mind would voluntarily want to be on the receiving end of that kind of instrumentality and at times downright animosity? So we approached this question as both writers and publishers. What would feel fair to us as writers in relationship with a publisher? What would feel fair to us as writer-publishers using our publishing skills to create a more spacious set of alternatives for other writers, as well as doing our own writing? Our collaborative approach is our answer. There are no villains and there is no entitlement. Everyone shares responsibility for the outcome. Everyone shares in the rewards. The rights authors assign are limited and for a limited duration, so a high degree of voluntariness is retained. However, we are interested in publishing writers who will, in turn, help publish other writers who want to ensure the success of the press as well. Mutuality for us is key at every level to healthy relationships. The collective is structured so that the press collective, once they have selected a writer's book as appropriate for the mission of the press, invests its funds and skills in the publication of the book. That writer then pays that collective investment in them forward through a uniform contribution to the collective publishing fund, and for 3 years, active participation on our collective editorial board, helping select new authors, donating their own time and editorial and other publishing skills to help publish other books, building new editorial and professional skills in the process. Collective authors speak not only for their own book, but for the whole press. The speaking for the whole includes speaking not only for the publications themselves, but also for this collaborative way of publishing as a viable option in the current publishing climate, one that uses high literary standards in the service of a clear social commitment that sees writing as a way to help us wise up individually and together, and understands that wising up to be a significant life-worthy measure of success in and of itself.